to building together. Rick Vossen, Stormore Portable Building Dealer, Panama City.
Ellis Agency Insurance has been serving Panama City and Bay County for years. They offer a full line of affordable insurance coverage of all types. Many people are attracted to Ellis Agency Insurance because of their friendly, knowledgeable staff. Call independent agent Johnny Ellis for a true comparison of your personal or business insurance. Ellis Agency Insurance at the Old Cullen Insurance location, 1134 Harrison Avenue, across from Dandy Donuts and Deli. Call 763-1627.
As a realtor, it's important who you choose as your title company. May we suggest South Oak Title? Their offices are modern, comfortable, and state-of-the-art. South Oak Title can close transactions in any location in Florida, Alabama, and Tennessee. Their free mobile app allows realtors to deliver a net sheet in seconds. They provide mobile closing services to accommodate buyers and sellers. Their offices are beautifully decorated, state-of-the-art, complete, safe, and secure. South Oak Title, creating a better title and closing experience through technology and tailored service. Visit them online at southoaktitle.com.
WVLQ Port St. Joe, WGSX Lynn Haven, powered by Panama City Toyota.
ESPN, Northwest Florida.
Let's play the game.
Sports Talk Radio will never be the same.
I just don't think that anybody's going to succeed in that system.
It's a bad organization.
It's just a bad organization.
The Afternoon Underdogs.
Onion pickles, onions, pickles.
Live and local.
Look, it's impressive.
On ESPN.
Northwest Florida.
What is up, Northwest Florida? You are now riding along with the Afternoon Underdogs. You're in the doghouse. This is ESPN Northwest Florida, 104.3 here in Panama City and 101.9 in Port St. Joe. I'm David Hayes along with Coach Brian Haddad and James Fife, and we've got a great show lined up for you guys this afternoon. We're going to take a few left turns in the next segment at 4:20 with RJ Starcevic. He'll get us caught up on what went down over there in Texas and what to look forward to at Talladega. And then at 4:40, Morgan Weller and Wahini are going to join us, talk a little bit about what's going on in the local sporting world of dogs. She just had a big event. James can tell us a little bit more about that. She'll be joining us today at 4:40.
Yeah, Wahini was part of the Fast Cat competition for the Nationals, actually, that took place in Arizona a few weeks ago, and it was premiered on ESPN2 last night. And, I'll just wait for Morgan to get here to tell you the outcome.
Awesome. Can't wait for that. 4:40, we're going to be diving in to Morgan and Wahini's story. Then at 5 o'clock, Steve Barnes, senior writer for TheRebelWalk.com, is going to join us. They had the Grove Games instead of a normal spring game. So he'll tell us about all how that went down. Alabama had their A-Day. Florida actually played their spring game on Saturday. How about that? First time in, I believe, 2 years, so Graham Mertz was excited to get back into that game. We'll talk more about the spring games at 5 o'clock with Steve Barnes, and then at 5:20, it'll be time for the PCB Hobby Takeover with Todd Mueller. We'll hear about the story of the week from the shop, and we will dive into some buy, sell, or hold. I'm curious to get Coach Brian's thoughts on Jackson Holliday. Is that a buy, sell, or a hold prospect? Not even a prospect. I mean, technically a prospect now, but he is underway in the major at the major league level, getting his first hit. Took him 3 games, but he did get that first hit.
If you're asking me for to go on and do that now,
no.
I thought we had to tease, didn't we?
Yeah, or 5:20. 5:20. Right. But what'd you think of his first 3 games as a big leaguer?
Not bad. You know, I mean, it's always tough when you come up with that much hype, and you know, everybody expected you to get called up, and then they sent you down, and your minor league team scores like 80 runs a game, and you know, they bring you back up. So, I mean, it was a bit of a roller coaster. I think he'd have probably been a little more settled if he'd have come up, you know, as the season started. But you know, come out and get an RBI in your first game, and you know, I think it was solid. You know, it's what's to be expected. I do think there's probably a bit of an advantage to the guys who come up their first couple of games until the pitchers kind of get a little more film on them and get an idea of what works and what doesn't. But Holliday is a significant talent, and he's on a team with a ton of talent. So, you know, Watch out for the O's.
Watch out for those Orioles in a division with the New York Yankees playing some really good baseball.
Surprisingly.
Right now, yeah, no doubt. It's absolutely surprising, and it's without one of their best pitchers. The pitching staff really isn't...
I would say their only pitcher, but yeah.
Exactly. Their pitching staff is... it leaves something to be desired when you look at the names, but to this point, it's been working.
Well, it's exactly the opposite of what I would have expected. I would have expected the Yankees to be hovering around 500, scoring a ton of runs, and giving up a ton of runs. The irony is, they're playing pretty good ball. They're not giving up a lot of runs. They're not, like, their margin of, or what is their
run differential.
Yeah, thank you. Those big words, you know. their run differential is one of the smallest for any team with a winning record, and there's even a few, I think, with a losing record that have a greater one. So they're not blowing teams out like you might expect with the firepower they have at the plate. It's just been a very different thing. The guys who are there pitching have exceeded expectation. And, you know, as a Yankee fan, I hope that continues. I'm a little cautiously optimistic, but I don't love the lack of depth of arms. And we'll see as the season goes on if that kicks in. But certainly I have no complaints through the first couple of weeks because the Yankees are playing great baseball.
Yeah, there you go. Atlanta Braves sitting at 9-5. Got a date with the Astros tonight. That game will be right here on ESPN Northwest Florida. Coverage starting at 6 o'clock, 7:10 for the first pitch. But 9-5 to this point in the season. Did get the series win over the Marlins, but man, I think they did everything in their power to not, outside of Marcell Ozuna yesterday having the big three-run fly to get it done. But yes, we're going to have to see what the pitching staff looks like moving forward for the Braves. I've seen some articles, and of course this is going to be a point of conversation with or without the injury to Spencer Strider, who is confirmed now to be out for the duration of 2024, and will have his second, or actually already has had his second Tommy John surgery. But yeah, I've heard people kind of getting deeper into the sign Max Fried now, you know, go ahead and get that extension out of the way. I think that now you're in a different position of, I don't think that that should even be your focus. This, why give him the money and then not give him the incentive, or not have the incentive available for him to pitch as well as he possibly could. So I think you hold on that and see how free agency goes.
Well, now you get into where business plays in, because if you're Max Fried's agent, you're just licking your chops at this. Like, nobody wants an injury, but the injury presents Max Fried and his agent the opportunity. And I say more as agent. Max probably just wants to pitch.
Yeah.
But presents his agent an opportunity to absolutely maximize based on the situation. And fans and other people who support the Braves are going to be naturally worried and want to lock something down, you know, full time, because you've got that extra level of anxiety as it relates to the Braves pitching staff depth. So it's a situation that will probably play out in Fried's favor. But by the same token, if you're the Braves front office staff, I think you're right. I think you do slow roll this, and that's a bit of a gamble, but you slow roll this a little bit, because right now you're not in an advantageous business situation. So that being said, the Braves are going to be an attractive team at the deadline, so it's not like they don't have options at pitching. So they have a bit of a counter in the negotiations, but certainly amped up negotiations in terms of long-term deals.
Yeah, we will see how that plays out. And I like what you said there, being an attractive team at the trade deadline. And they will be, and we'll see what plays out there. Obviously, AA has done phenomenal things at the deadline and in the off seasons as well to have this Braves club competing at the level that it's competing at. Oh, Justin wants to know your worst of the weekend, so we'll dive into that in just a second. I did have the opportunity to play over there at Gulf Coast State College yesterday afternoon for the alternative baseball organization. They had a game where some of the guys from their other organizations, or same organization but different leagues around different cities, came to participate with the Panama City Bull Sharks, and it was a day of integration for those with disabilities and other former ball players. We actually had a former AAA baseball player there, Colton Shaver,
nice.
Who was playing catcher, and it was a lot of fun yesterday. I know that they had a blast. We had a blast. It was a great time over there at Gulf Coast State College. Great crowd. You had John Moore there, Colton Shaver, Sam Peebles, other commissioners. I was there. So it was a great time. Even made an error or two. Well, really only one error, but and then got an opportunity to pitch. And so that was fun slinging. It's like a baseball, but it's actually rubber,
mm-hmm.
and so it's very bouncy. That thing was bouncing on the infield like crazy, but it was a lot of fun, and really thankful to be a part of that inclusivity. It was a great time. Taylor Clark Duncan puts on a phenomenal show, and it was just a great day of baseball. One of the most fun experiences that I've ever had in the game of baseball.
That's awesome. No, those events are always a blast. I used to be involved in things like that years and years ago, and just the joy in playing the game, and it's infectious. So good for you guys for being out there and putting that on and being a part of it.
Justin goes on to say, I can't believe I complimented your Marlins hat last week. Now you've got this horrific hat on today. Get used to it, Justin. I'm always in a different lid for the most part, and I love my retro baseball caps. I love baseball mm-hmm. hats in general, though. All right, real quick, we'll go through some local scores from the weekend in high school baseball from Friday. Arnold got their get back. They beat Mosley 3-1. Cooper Moss pitched a complete game, allowing just 5 hits, 1 run, and 2 walks, striking out 11 of them, though. And he hit a top velocity of 97 miles an hour. He is a University of Florida commit, and he also hit a 2-run home run in the top of the 4th to break the tie and give them the game-winning home run. Arnold winning 3-1. Cottondale beat Sneed's 3-2. North Bay Haven fell to Rutherford 4-3. Ponce de Leon beat Vernon 8-6. Jay took down Holmes by 3, 5-2. Walton over Bay 2-1. Poplar Springs beat Sampson 17-2. South Walton over Destin. The score there was 15-0. Port St. Joe beat Freeport 4-3. And then Blountstown trounced Bethlehem 19-1. In high school softball, it was Malone beating Jefferson by 22 runs. It was 23-1. Blountstown ekes out a win over Franklin 11-10. Arnold shuts out Mariana 2-0. Liberty beats North Florida 7-6. Tate over Niceville 3-1. South Walton shutting out Holmes County 2-0. Ponce de Leon falling by 5 to Freeport 10-5. And then FSU High School over Port St. Joe 6-3. High school softball from Saturday, Arnold beat West Florida in 10 innings. Final score there, 2-1. JUCO softball, Gulf Coast with a pair of wins over Tallahassee. In game one, it was 8-0. And game two, 6-2. And JUCO baseball, Gulf Coast State College was on the road. And they won the first game against Chipola 7-4 and then lost game two, 7-6. Justin says, go Cubs, go. Wright State, Chris, with how about them tied? Arkansas baseball now has 3 SEC losses instead of just one. Bama got them on, I believe it was, did they play Thursday, Friday, Saturday?
I'll have to look because some of them played Thursday, Friday, Saturday, but I think most played Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Let me
Arkansas got the first game, then the second game, which was either on Friday or Saturday night, went to 10 innings. Bama got the better of them then, and then got the third game of the series as well. I believe that one was 5-3, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, let's see here. Arkansas. Yeah, Arkansas took Friday 5-3. Bama wins 4-3 in 10 innings, like you said, on Saturday.
And
then blanks them 5-0 on Sunday to take the series over number one Arkansas.
Yeah, that's a pretty big win right there. Northwest Florida head baseball coach Doug Martin reached his 500th career victory with the Raiders on the road Saturday against Tallahassee. He is in his 16th season and has got 3 Panhandle Conference titles in 2011, 2019, and 2023, one FCSAA Region 8 championship.
Championship in 2015 and then one national championship also in 2015 to go with his 500 wins. Northwest Florida is currently in command of first place in the Panhandle Conference and is looking for back-to-back conference titles. We'll do our best and worst of the week, and we'll get to Brian's here in a minute, but we'll start off with what was posted or what was commented on the Facebook post. The best for James Kelly says Chase winning at Texas snaps his winless streak at 42, and the worst for Atlanta, Spencer Strider done for the year. Mike Howdy McDaniel says best was the Ryan Patrick Mulvey scramble, the Ryan Mulvey scramble rally for Ryan, and the worst for him was his play at said scramble. That was a great event, man. And I don't think I told this story Friday, and I don't think that they told it on the Inside Drive this morning, but if they did, I was out of the room for a minute. So we pull up to, I forget which hole it was. I want to say maybe it was 16. And Ryan is pulling up at the hole at the same time. So we're about 50 feet away from the cup. And I'm like, Ryan, why don't you take my putt? So he's like, I don't know, you know. And I'm like, just putt for me, man. Got a brand new putter out. Hasn't ever used that particular putter. Our three guys go ahead and putt. They miss. Jay gets it a little close. Maybe Ryan Cox did as well, too. And then Ryan steps up and drains it.
Jars it. Of course
from
he does.
50 feet away, man. It might have been even further than that, but it was absolutely amazing. And our team ended up shooting 15 under.
Nice.
But the winning team in that particular flight was 19 under, and it was led by Chase Seifert. So.
Well, he can play.
Yeah, he can play a little bit.
The question is, did Ryan halfway, when the ball's halfway to the cup, did he just walk off with his finger in the air?
Oh, man. You know what? I don't know if he did. I think he knew for a good minute, that it was going in, though. It was a great time. Saw him hit a few drives as well. So continued thoughts and prayers, though, with the Mulvey family at this time. David Kelly says, Scotty dominating at Augusta. I know one of the worst for Brian has got to be the Masters in general, right?
Well, I was going to say my worst of the weekend was Mississippi State losing the series to Ole Miss, but we'll get into that with Steve at 5. That'll be enough punishment for me. But I would say my best and worst are from the Masters. The best is Scottie Scheffler dominating the field on the back nine, winning his second Masters in 3 years. I think he's only the second player to win two in his first five, and the other one was Horton Smith, who won two of the first three they ever had.
Wow. that goes way back.
But my worst, I didn't watch a single swing.
Yeah.
And part of that, I did have some work. I was out of town. I did have some work I had to do. But Thursday, the Masters used to be holy day for me. I would have my television, my tablet, my laptop, my phone, all with different holes and different footage. I would just sit there and just geek out. And the whole live PGA split, it hasn't soured me on golf, but it's disinterested me. And to the point that it didn't kill me that I didn't watch a swing of the Masters. That's the first time that I can remember in my life I have not watched anything of the Masters. And this was what I worried about years ago when this started, and I brought up the CART and IRL split in open wheel racing. Is it did the exact same thing for me for that, and it took 20 years for me to come back. So hopefully it won't be as bad with golf. Maybe some of it was just situational, but the fact that I didn't watch a single swing of the Masters and it didn't kill me is bothersome.
Yeah, when you showed up
here. And I can't be the only fan.
When you showed up here today after finding out that you didn't watch any of the Masters, I was surprised that it didn't kill you as well.
Yeah.
Coach Old saying, best Magic are locked in the playoffs. Got a great play-in tournament, FSU softball. And for his worst, he's horrible at fantasy golf. Terry Ross says, Oklahoma City beating Dallas. Bart says, his best was seeing Tiger Woods play golf and FSU sweep of Miami in baseball. The worst, easy. Columbia Lions blowing an 8-0 lead after 7 innings and losing 8-10 in 9 innings to Yale. What a way to break a 9-game win streak. not. Derek says Bulls lost 119 to 120 yesterday, and the Cubbies win Saturday and Sunday. Fly the W. Richard Bodon says seeing Tiger Woods finish the Masters and the Knicks getting the 2 seed, Spencer Strider out of the year was the worst. Yes, those NBA playoffs about to get started. Play-in games for the West are on Tuesday, and I believe the Easts are on Wednesday. Best for Coach Mitchell, Scotty's Masters win, and the worst, he's still a little bitter about Bama going down in the Final Four. And then for Johnny Yankee Seed, best was UFC 300. The whole card was amazing. Worst was he didn't want the card to end. Hands down, might be the most complete card I've ever seen. That $300,000 bonus brought it out for us. And one of the greatest fights of the night, I would say the greatest fight of the night, one of the greatest fights I've ever seen. Joe Rogan coined it as the best knockout he's ever seen for the BMF belt between Justin Gaethje and Max Holloway. And then right there in the final 10 seconds, Max just points him out. I mean, he broke his nose early in the fight with the little heel to the nose. And I think that was in the very end of the first round. And then to point him out there and knock him out with 1 second remaining, just absolutely amazing and great stuff. As Johnny Yankee Seed said, the whole card was amazing. Michigan Eddie, you are now riding with the Afternoon Underdogs. What's up, my guy?
Go Blue Truck, your Ranch City's Bank Kennel. What is up, fellas? Happy Monday to you. Top of the week to you. Golly, I'm dragging. Got in late from Atlanta yesterday after we had a perfect game tournament at East Cobb. But I got a interesting story to tell you about East Cobb Little League Travel Baseball. So Eddie's team, Showcase Baseball Academy, 2028 Torres, got knocked out in the semis by Team Elite. Had a bunch of nationally ranked players, held their own 4-0. Eddie pitched two strikeouts. After the game, Goody's dad comes up to me. He goes, because Eddie's main team, the national team, which Eddie too was a feeder of, they got a bunch of nationally ranked kids on their team. They fly in all over. Guess whose son was playing for Showcase Baseball Academy national team? I'm sitting there. They're warming up, going to play the final, which we wanted to be an all-Showcase Baseball Academy final, but unfortunately we got knocked out. Southwest another day. Guess whose son flew from California to play on this team, bro? I mean, unbelievable.
Freddie Freeman.
Hunter Pence's kid.
Oh,
Stryker
nice.
Striker Pence. Like, Goody Day goes, yeah, that's Striker Pence. I'm like, who? That's Hunter Pence's kid. I'm like, no, you're kidding, right? And yeah, man. I mean, it's crazy. But then the team, Eddie's team lost, dude, like I said, they had the number one ranked kid in 14U on the team, Colin Anderson. I mean, these kids are a huge beat, like nationally ranked, man. And that's why Eddie plays down in Orlando, man, to play against competition like that, man, to get the competition, go to East Cobb, because iron sharpens iron, man. You know, you get better by playing against the best than with the best, and Eddie gets that with Showcase Baseball Academy and Team Torres, bro. I'm just telling you straight up. But I just had to tell you that, man, you know?
Yeah, that's a great story, and awesome for Eddie as well to be able to be in the to be on the same diamond with those guys. And what do you got, James?
I got some for after we're done talking. I got a question for Eddie.
All right, well, go ahead.
Hey, Eddie. Yeah, how about that Denver University?
Well, yeah, I mean, they beat Michigan for most NCAA titles, 10-9. Good on them. They did it fair and square, and you just got to tip your cap, you know, and it is what it is. I mean, but here's the thing. Michigan never should have been in the Frozen Four this year. They had a young team. For them to get that far this year was pretty dang good, so I'm proud of them. But I wish we wouldn't have lost. You know, it is what it is. But DU Pioneers, bro, champs. NCAA hockey, bro.
Yes, know? Sir. Hey, man.
Were you expecting me to be mad?
I think he was, but
I wanted you to be a little bit disappointed.
Just a wee bit. And maybe next time we can make that happen. Michigan Eddie, we are up against the break. Thank you so much for the call.
Yeah, no problem. God bless you. Go with Sharks here. And Eddie had a personal record 77 miles an hour on the mountain. I'm out. See ya.
There you go.
God bless the USA. We are going to take a quick timeout. We're going to come back with RJ Starcevic talking about what went down in Texas yesterday afternoon. We'll be right back. This is ESPN Northwest.
America's team plays here.
Swing and a miss. struck him out. That's number 10.
The Atlanta Braves on ESPN Northwest Florida. Charlie Morton, Max Fried, and Chris Sale lead the Braves' dominant pitching rotation.
That's 18 up, 18 down.
Sponsored by Panama City Toyota, LS Agency Insurance, Bestway Portable Buildings, PCB Hobby, and ESPN Northwest Florida.
Got him swinging, strike three.
Good afternoon. This is Joanna with your weather forecast from ESPN Northwest Florida on this Monday. Sunny the rest of the day with a wind out of the south at 11 miles per hour and 75. Tonight, look for a calm wind and mostly clear skies with a temperature near 62. Tomorrow, high around 78 and slightly foggy in the morning, but otherwise some sun. Wednesday, hot with a high of 76 and some clouds. This weather forecast is brought to you by Ellis Agency Insurance. Thank you for keeping that dial at ESPN Northwest Florida. Rely on it.
Hey there, folks. Looking for a place that feels like home right in the heart of Panama City? We'll look no further than Charlie Corm's place at their new location on 15th Street. Charlie Corm's is not just a place, it's an experience. Imagine cozy corners, friendly faces, and the aroma of delicious dishes that'll make your taste buds dance. From sunrise breakfast to late night bites, Charlie Corm's on 15th Street has it all. Charlie Corm's place on 15th Street is now offering exclusive weekday lunch specials. Visit Charlie Corm's place on 15th Street. Look for the giant mural.
In the jewelry business, there is no substitute for experience. David Adamson has over 46 years of experience, 32 of those in Lynn Haven. Designing and creating fine jewelry is more than a job for David. It's a joy. If you're looking for a spectacular jewelry design that says you, or perhaps you need your jewelry repaired, look no further than David Adamson Designer Jewelry. All work is done in-house and always to your complete satisfaction. Stop in today at David Adamson Designer Jewelry, 830 Ohio Avenue in Lynn Haven. They're on Facebook and at pcjeweler.com.
Atlanta Braves baseball is back, and the battle for a seventh straight division title is officially on.
Stretching the pitch. Swung on, lifted left field. That might get out of here. That's in the bullpen. Home run, Sean Murphy.
Tonight, it's a big American League matchup from Minute Maid Park in Houston as Michael Harris and the Braves take on the Houston Astros.
Coverage starts at 6, first pitch 7:10 tonight. On your home for the Atlanta Braves on the Gulf Coast, it's ESPN Northwest Florida.
ESPN Northwest Florida. He entered a kid's 1 mile fun run and came in ninth. David Hayes is part of the Afternoon Underdogs. Weekdays 4 to 6 on ESPN Northwest Florida and the ESPN Northwest Florida app.
Welcome back into the doghouse. This is ESPN Northwest Florida, 104.3 here in Panama City and 101.9 in Port St. Joe. We're the Afternoon Underdogs. I'm David Hayes along with Brian Haddad and James Fife. Y'all make sure to stay locked in this segment and the next segment. Well, for the rest of the show, but coming up next, we've got Morgan and Wahini. But now we're going to be talking with RJ Starcevic, who is the host of the NASCAR Report, well, the creator of the NASCAR Report, and you can find that on Instagram. RJ, my man, lots of stuff to break down over there at Texas. How is your afternoon going?
Going good. I'm out here at the office over at the workplace. Hopefully you guys got me all good, and it's a nice sunny day here in Tampa, Florida.
It is a beautiful day as well. Man, the last few days have just been absolutely striking. Give us a recap of what went down over there in Texas.
Yeah, Texas Motor Speedway, we had a pretty solid race, pretty eventful race. It's been ever since they have repaved that racetrack, it has been very, very prone to cautions. And that's exactly what happened. We tied, I believe, the record for most cautions in a race at Texas, which was only set 2 years ago, back in 2022. So we've been racking up the cautions. We had a few of them there at the end of the race. It was a Chevy-dominated race. We had Kyle Larson in one stage one, Ross Chastain won stage two, and Chase Elliott ends up with the victory. But it didn't come easy. We had two overtime restarts, one with Denny Hamlin just losing the air on the nose as Chase Elliott slid up in front of him. He backs into the wall. We get another restart. Ross Chastain gets a shot at it. But it's ultimately Chase Elliott pulling out in front. And, hey, man, just like I believe it was the last 2 weeks, I shot you a text after the race. I was like, well, I guess that puts the will Chase Elliott win this year question to rest, because, you know, I didn't see it coming this early, but I did see them kind of getting on the right track. But, hey, what do you know? Nine cars back in victory lane.
They are on the right track, at the right track for him as well. 42 races without a W, but that is no longer a streak in the back of Chase Elliott's mind. How many more wins do you see for Chase Elliott and his team in 2024?
I'm going to go, I say they get 3 wins this year. I'll go big, just because I think, you know, they've been showing a lot of stats, you know, on this race Monday here, that Hendrick Motorsports and Joe Gibbs Racing are killing it right now. And those are the two teams that have all the wins, all the glory. They're at the top of the point standing. So I think Chase Elliott's going to ride the momentum. I think that team, they've been good. They've been versatile as well at multiple different tracks. And so I think that will just lead them to possibly getting a few wins here down the road.
All right. And what do you make of all of the wrecks that went down yesterday in Texas?
I think just product of the track. It is so treacherous. I think, you know, they want to call it treacherous Texas now, you know, before we do end up maybe repaving or reconfiguring that track again. You can really can only run. It's such a wide track, right? But you can only run like 2 lanes down there on the bottom. You get above that and you're crashed. And so you're on edge. You still are going very fast in the Cup Series and the Xfinity Series, no matter what series is racing there. It's very treacherous, very prone to getting crashed. And you can just see how easy it is to spin out. Like, you know, when we were watching the fin, it's hard to watch those battles where we see crashes maybe at the middle of the pack or the back of the pack. But that battle between Elliott and Hamlin, that just shows how easy it is to wreck there. I mean, 2 guys racing for the lead. Elliott slides up just a tiny bit, and then Hamlin has no choice but, you know, his car just spins out. So very, very tough track.
James wants to know if you think Elliott is going to stay with this aggressive mindset that he's had.
I think so. You know, I don't see them as a team where it's like, okay, you know, the win's definitely going to bring relief, right? You know, they're going to have a great week of celebration, right? You're in the playoffs. You are 4th in the point standings. You finally got that win in very thrilling fashion. But, you know, I don't see them as a team that's just going to lay off the gas pedal. I think still until we get to the regular season, you know, they're still in the regular season championship hunt. You know, that gives you something to fight for. So I think, you know, they're gonna keep the pound on it. They're going to keep the momentum and keep chasing wins.
How was Jimmy Johnson's day yesterday?
Not good. Not good at all. It started out, he spun out, and then they ended up, you know, finishing back in the 29th position. He was running at the end of the race, but, you know, it's been a struggle for Jimmy Johnson to get acclimated to this next-gen car, which it's been for a lot of drivers that really have been through a lot of car changes, you know, notably Kevin Harvick. I think Kevin Harvick being on the broadcast now has kind of definitely provided a lot of insight onto what the, you know, the change is like. It's a totally different car to drive. Jimmy Johnson explained that in one of his media availabilities, but he's got some more races down the road this year. You know, he's running almost 10 races this year, so this was just the second of those, and he'll be back and hopefully with some more glory.
Who was impressive yesterday?
I got to give that to the RCR bunch. 8th and 9th place finishes, Austin Dillon, who's been pretty historically good at Texas. No matter what configuration, he's ended up with some good finishes at Texas. Obviously, he won there 4 years ago. And Kyle Busch finishing in the 9th position after they crash in practice. You know, he's had an abysmal year, lots of spins, especially in this next-gen car, to come home with a 9th place finish. And then sneaking in right behind him, I got to give an honorable mention to Carson Hocevar. That's the first top 10 for Spire Motorsports that was not a super speedway. So not Daytona, not Atlanta, not Talladega. Hocevar races up there on those late restarts, and he gets a 10th place spot.
You're listening to ESPN Northwest Florida. We're on the line with RJ Starcevic. He is the creator of the NASCAR Report, and that is on Instagram. Make sure you go give that a follow. What do you think's happening in the Truex Jr. camp? It seems like there's something going wrong there for the last 3 weeks.
Yeah, I think, you know, and I'm not sure. I mean, you know, this week at Texas, they never, you know, they're not going to stick out to me as a big contender. But I believe, you know, he was on my pick chart for Martinsville, and they just did not have the speed there. So obviously, you know, going into this week, it's going to be hard to tell what kind of speed you have at Talladega. But after Talladega, you got three tracks, Dover, Kansas, Darlington, all tracks where he's been great at. More specifically, Dover and Darlington, I think those are the tracks where they'll have to pick it up and really show us what they're made of.
All right, let's get your top five drivers in RJ's high-powered rankings.
Yeah, we're going to leave Kyle Larson there up at number one. I still think that he is the guy to beat. I think, you know, he was pretty much one of the fastest cars, if not the fastest one, at Texas. And then let's go with Denny Hamlin. I'd put him at second. I mean, he came so close to winning the race at Texas, unfortunately spinning out there with just a few laps to go. I'll throw Chase Elliott there in third. He's been really fast. And, you know, obviously winning the race at Texas, he's got a lot of momentum on his side. William Byron, I'll slot in there at fourth. They've still been really fast, really consistent. And then I'll go ahead and let's put Tyler Reddick here in the power rankings, because these are power rankings. You know, Martin Truex Jr. still sits in second right overall in the standings, but they ain't had much power lately. So I got to go with maybe Tyler Reddick slotting in there, who's been pretty fast lately. He'll be in there at the five spot.
The CW is going to be taking over the Xfinity Series for the final eight races of the season. How do you feel about that?
Yeah, I mean, I think that'll be pretty cool for the Xfinity Series. It'll be pretty cool for fans, for viewers to, you know, it'll still be produced by NBC and everything like that. But, you know, there's going to be the aspect where viewers will now tune into CW. So I think it's cool. As far as getting ready for 2025, now everybody will know where to go, where to tune in to the CW network. But we will still have Rick Allen, Steve Letarte, Jeff Burton in the booth. So it'll be still NBC doing everything, but it'll just be on a different channel, the CW network. So in my opinion, I think that'll be cool because it'll still be the same produced. It'll still be NBC, which is definitely what we love. As a lot of the racing viewers love. So that won't be taken away. But the viewers will be directed to the CW network.
Do you think that the Xfinity Series will notice or see any drop off from viewership by going over to the CW network, or do you think that maybe that could be a shot in the arm for their ratings?
You know, I've never really looked at, you know, and I need to look into what kind of the viewership for CW, like sports on CW, is. I know they're starting to take on a lot more sports, the Xfinity Series just being one of them. So I feel like when it begins, maybe viewership won't be as high, but, you know, hopefully it'll be a thing that'll progress, you know, as we go on. But maybe CW's killing it with sports viewership. I don't know. And they'll come over there and all of a sudden it'll spike up. But I know just for the regular NASCAR fan, it'll probably take a little bit for it to, you know, to convert over. But I know that the broadcast networks will be making sure, obviously, that they promote it as much as they can. So I think we should be in good hands.
For some reason, I just get the feeling that NASCAR fans are the most stubborn when it comes to change. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, I guess it depends what kind of change, but any of the change, I guess, is going with the new era, per se. And so I definitely think that when we change things, there's always probably a little bit of taking a step back at first. But, you know, a lot of us more into the sport, you know, can kind of look at things from a analytical standpoint. And can make a reason to why, you know, they're making such change. So, I mean, I know change that people support or change in Texas Motor Speedway, I think everybody's behind that. I mean, maybe there's some that's not, but, you know, I think if we're talking about maybe changes that everyone's behind, that might be one of them.
There you go. Yeah, I would say NASCAR fans, baseball fans, then maybe football fans after that. Hockey fans aren't huge fans of change either. And I would say NBA fans are like, whatever, just give us whatever you give us and we'll move along with that. Let's see here. Up next we've got, give us a recap of the Xfinity race real quick, RJ.
Yeah, Xfinity race was about the same as far as cautions. I mean, like I said, tough Xfinity truck, lots of wrecks. But we saw one of the closest finish, if not the closest finish. You know, there's a lot of different categories when you talk about just time, decades, and things like that, how we measured things. But nonetheless, Sam Mayer and Ryan Sieg had an absolutely incredible finish to end that race. Ryan Sieg, who is, you know, drives for his family-owned team, he's got four cars now in the Xfinity Series. They've been doing really well, but he is like an Xfinity Series veteran. He's been in that sport for over a decade, and he was coasting to his first ever career win after 400-plus starts, and Sam Mayer comes out his long run car starts kicking in, and on the final lap, Mayer gets by. See, tried the crossover, he tried to get him back. They come to the line, and just by an inch or half an inch, however much, Ryan Sieg lost that race. So it was definitely heartbreaking for a lot of, you know, NASCAR fans, people in the garage that would have wanted to see Ryan Sieg win. But on the flip side, there you go. Sam Mayer finally gets himself to victory lane. I mean, to put it in perspective, they're 14th in the point standings overall, and they were having a pretty rough year. So now they get that win, and they're locked into the playoffs. So a definitely turn up the tide for them, but heartbreak for Ryan Sieg, man.
And up next, we are going to be at Talladega. Give me your favorite fact, RJ, about Talladega.
Man, just the racing. I think the thrill, that's the word I'm looking for. I mean, I know anytime NASCAR goes to Talladega, it's a phenomenon. All the fans there having a good time. The campgrounds, I was blessed to be able to go there one time a few years back, take an RV trip to Talladega, and it was an absolute blast of a time. You got Xfinity Series and the Cup Series there this weekend. Both of them are going to put on great races. The Geico 500, always the trademark Talladega race of the year, although we do head there twice, but I can't wait for it.
All right, and one of my favorite times of the week helps me get a little research started for our picks on the Inside Drive. Give me your top three for the Xfinity Series and top three for the Cup Series there at Talladega Super Speedway.
Yeah, over there in the Xfinity Series, I'm looking at Sam Mayer, who's been really good on super speedways, to maybe go back-to-back. That would be really cool to see him go back-to-back. A.J. Allmendinger has won there before. I'd love to see him get in victory lane. And then the third pick is easy. We got to go with Austin Hill. He's undefeated on super speedways this year. Basically undefeated on super speedways in life, it seems. I think he is definitely the man to beat. Everyone is going to be wanting to conquer Austin Hill this weekend. And then we move over to the Cup Series, where I think somebody like Ross Chastain wants to get in victory lane there at Talladega. That'll mean both trackhouse drivers have won this season. That's something that I'm sure everyone would love to see, including Justin Marsh, their team owner. I'll roll over there and say, let's go with maybe Josh Berry being a contender this week. I know he's not a big super speedway guy, but we see so many wrecks at the end of these races, and I know that they're very results-focused going into the weekend. I think he could be somebody to watch out for. And then let's go with somebody like Ryan Blaney. Ryan Blaney's been a very strong contender on super speedways. Great at Daytona, but even better at Talladega. He's won so many times at Talladega. The last time he went to Talladega, he was the winner. I'd say he is someone to watch for sure.
As always, RJ, that was a lot of fun, and we appreciate you giving us the recap of Texas and the preview of Talladega. Definitely keeping an eye on your high-powered rankings, and we look forward to chatting with you next week. My man, have a great week.
Awesome. Thank you, guys. You guys as well.
Absolutely. That's RJ Starcevic. Y'all go check out his Instagram page, the NASCAR Report. Lots of great content that he puts out over there on Instagram. And then you can go follow him on Twitter as well. You guys are riding along with the Afternoon Underdogs. This is ESPN Northwest Florida. And coming up next, we're going to have Morgan and Wahini, who were on ESPN2 just last night.
ESPN Northwest Florida. The Coach James Hale Show.
Maybe Congress can fix this. That's how bad the NCAA is. Congress has a worse approval rating than Satan does. I mean, it's unbelievable.
He'll have to show up for work.
That was awesome. We're going to go out on that. I can't beat that one.
Weekday morning, 7 to 9. ESPN Northwest Florida.
Good afternoon, this is Joanna with your weather forecast from ESPN Northwest Florida on this Monday. Sunny the rest of the day with a wind out of the south at 11 miles per hour and 75. Tonight look for a calm wind and mostly clear skies with a temperature near 62. Tomorrow, a high around 78 and slightly foggy in the morning but otherwise some sun. Wednesday hot with a high of 76 and some clouds. This weather forecast is brought to you by Ellis Agency Insurance. Thank you for keeping that dial at ESPN Northwest Florida. Rely on it.
Los Rancheros has been doing it right for 20 years. Los Rancheros brings a top-shelf dining experience to you with the opening of their beautiful new building. Watch all college and pro games on Los Rancheros' 14 large-screen TVs with great drink specials daily from 2 to 5 and during all the games. Los Rancheros, the place for live sports and great food on 23rd Street between Jenks and Harrison.
Are you looking for a place to take a leak? Do you have a truck, tractor, or other hydraulic equipment leaking or not performing as it should? At Reliable Hydraulic Solutions, we can get you back to work. Do you have a bus that are leaking hose? We can typically replace them while you wait. Hydraulic cylinder or pump needing repair? In many cases, we can have it back to you the next day. Reliable Hydraulic Solutions, 6840 Highway 77 in Southport, just south of Tractor Supply. The best place in town to take a leak.
Hometown Sports Talk from hometown hosts.
People are loving it.
We're live and local. Now back to the Afternoon Underdogs.
Are you kidding me?
104.3 ESPN Northwest Florida.
In the doghouse, this is the Afternoon Underdogs. We've got a very special underdog with us. It may not be an underdog. It might be a favorite dog. But either way, this is the Afternoon Underdogs on ESPN Northwest Florida. I'm David Hayes, along with Brian Haddad, James Fife, Morgan Weller, and Wahine. I want to remind you guys real quick about Wrestling Against Cancer 9. That is going to be at Bay Haven Charter Academy Saturday, April 27th. Doors opening at 5:30, and the bell time is at 6:30. All proceeds go to Jaden's medical expenses. He is in remission, but the bills do not stop just because you're in remission. Tickets are $12 for adults. Kids 6 through 17 get in for $8, and 5 and under get in free with a paid adult. I'll be doing the ring announcing over there, so let's come pack the place out. The Bay Haven Charter Academy, April 27th for Wrestling Against Cancer 9. That is sure to be a great time. All right, Morgan Weller and Wahine. We'll have to have Wahine answer first. Wahine, how are you doing today? No, but how are you guys doing? Thank you guys so much for coming along.
We are doing great. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, absolutely. So what breed is Wahine?
Wahine is a beagle. She's from hunting line, so you don't really see this color in like the normal, like the show lines and the pet lines. So this is what it is.
What is the color of like the bottom of her belly, like around her legs? What do you call that?
It's called blue tick.
Blue tick. Yeah, I love that pattern. That's awesome. So what competition did she just compete in?
We went to Fastest Dogs USA in Glendale, Arizona. It was held at the same place that the Cardinals play.
Oh, and, really?
Wow.
Yeah.
Let's go.
Yeah. Oh, it was awesome. Like, so yeah, we got the invite from AKC and ESPN, and we're like, man, we're going.
How does that work out? Do they come scout you guys, or do you put in some sort of material and they find? How does that work?
No, they found us. So she, ever since she started doing Fast Cat, she's always been in the top 5 of her breed.
Yeah.
And this year at Fastest Dogs USA, they had, you know, your ultra fast dogs that, you know, like the Greyhounds and Whippets and the stuff that you think about. And then they also have like other breeds that get showcased at that. So this year it was Beagles, Labs, and also Pekingeses, which are like the weird little like Chinese.
Yeah. They're real small, right?
Yeah, they're small and they kind of look like a mop. Like,
yeah. And they're fast?
No, not at all.
She's like, hey, you know what?
But hey,
participation party or participation races.
I was honestly shocked they could get down to the end of like the 100 yards because like we have to run 100 yards, and you know it was really funny. I mean, it took a while. We were all just sitting there on the sidelines, just watching this wig run down the field.
Yeah,
man,
it's like, whoa, dude, somebody lose their hair up there? How in the world? What's going on? So how do you guys train, and how much do you train and where?
So I own a training company, the dog trainers here locally in Panama City, and I also train out of the Greater Panama City Dog Fanciers Association,
okay,
which is like the local AKC club. But as far as like keeping her in shape, like I've always been really into like canine fitness since I was a police handler.
Okay.
So, like, I would learn from people that would do, like, the sled dog races and pit bull people and, you know, just anything that I could learn from the people that had the really, really in-shape dogs so we were safe on the street.
Yeah.
So I started with my Mals, which were dual-purpose canines, and I raised the Beagle like I would have my Mountain.
Ah, gotcha. Is there a big difference in different breeds when it comes to training them, or do you try to train them all the same?
Well, you know, I try to do everything the happy way. You know, if the dog isn't happy, they're not gonna run fast and they're not gonna hit hard, you know.
Yeah.
So like I find what they like the most and we go from there.
So when did you figure out she was as fast as what, or like as capable as being fast as she is?
You know, it's so funny. It's like I was never really planning on doing any of this. I just saw Fast Cat on the internet, thought it looked fun, and my kids and I went over to Pensacola, and she ran for the first time. And I looked at her times, and I looked at where Beagles are. You know, they have the charts for each breed.
Yeah,
and from her very first race, she was already like ranked number two. So I was like, okay, we're actually
doing
something
here. So what's her top speed?
Her top speed, so she ran 100 yards in 7.9 seconds one time. So about 26 was her top.
Do y'all ever do 40 times?
What's that?
Do y'all ever do 40 times? Like 40 yards. It's a
oh yeah,
thing.
No. It's always 100.
Yeah.
I don't think 40 would give them enough.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Space.
Yeah, but if you were to subtract that, or you know, do the mathematics there, and what her 40-yard time would be compared to some of the NFL football players, I think she's got them by a few steps there. That's very impressive. 7.9 seconds and 100 yards.
Yeah.
Wow. Does she get like? Is there a difference when you guys are doing training and she's running for just you, and then when you get into that situation where ESPN and all their cameras are there?
So no, she's really, really solid. I mean, she works as a search and rescue canine,
okay.
And we've also I used to be a police officer with Bay District Schools, and so she would be at school with all the screaming fun kids, and so she is super like rock solid when it comes to like everything, you know.
So what else does Wahini do?
So she's a search and rescue dog. She detects narcotics. She competes in agility. A couple of obedience sports. Basically, I throw stuff at the wall and I see what sticks, you know?
There you
and we
go.
Just keep finding new stuff to do.
That is awesome. So what is the, out of those different disciplines, if you will, I guess that's what we can call them for now, what would you call those? Just different?
Yeah, that's a good word.
All right, that'll work then. So what's the hardest to train a dog in? Or let's say for Wahini, what has she been the toughest to train in, or is she just easy peasy?
Yeah, she's easy as far as beagles go, but probably our hardest has been agility.
Okay.
So, like, she's a star dog, so she loves everybody. And, you know, we've gone into competition, and we're doing really good. She's running the obstacles, and then all of a sudden she sees somebody that looks fun, and she's like, oh, yeah, we got to go say hi.
Yeah.
She'll come back and run the course, but she just loves people.
how long have you been working with dogs?
Oh, I've been working with dogs pretty much my whole life.
Yeah.
Pretty much my whole life. I started when I was like 9 years old competing in obedience. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, I was always like the weird dog kid. So it just, I grew up into the weird dog adult, you know?
Yeah. So you were 9 years old.
Yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So, man. And since then you've been doing this. Is there what would be your favorite dog, breed of dog to work with?
Oh, Belgian Malinois for sure. Like I have, I've always had them. I don't suggest them for pets because they're like a very, very high-strung, shepherd.
Okay.
But they're really fun to work. They love to bite stuff, and you know, that's just who they are. They're just all the way, all the time.
Do you ever get put that thing on your arm? What do you call that when you like when you have a German Shepherd come bite you or whatever kind of dog?
Yeah, so I have sleeves. I have bite suits. I've decoyed forever, and I love it. Usually when I'm in hard decoy mode, like you'll see me coming in all bruised up, and
so it hurts. Even if you got the suit on, it still hurts.
Oh yeah, you feel it. I mean, you don't feel teeth, and it doesn't like rip, but like you feel the pressure of like the jaws of the dog, and like it bruises you up, and oh, it's so fun.
Yeah, it's so fun. This is awesome. Oh, yes. Was it nerve-wracking like when you first started getting into that though, like, and you got this dog just running 100 miles an hour at you?
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Man, it's like I still get adrenaline rushes from it, man. It's, you know, you're facing an animal that you know, like, is trained to take you down, and like, oh, it's fun, man. It's very, very cool.
So do you where you work at now, do y'all take a point, like if one of our listeners was like, I would like her to work with my dog, how would they set that up?
Yeah, so my company is called The Dog Trainers. We're
that's easy to find right there.
Yeah,
right?
I try to keep it simple. I'm on thedogtrainers.com. All of my information is on there, my phone, email address, everything. And also I do a lot of classes, like sport dog classes, at our local dog club, which is gpcdfa.org. And you'll see all of our classes. We do agility, scent work, tracking, you know, even just regular like obedience. We want your dog to act right, like, come on, you know, like, and we accept everybody. A lot of people are like, okay, AKC doesn't like, you know, mixed breed dogs, but we accept everybody.
There you go, all inclusive. I love that. How long have you been with Bay County Search and Rescue?
My first dog that was on Bay County Search and Rescue, that was probably, I would say, about 12, 13 years ago. So I haven't been on the team like the whole time, because like there was a couple times that I moved away from here. And but I've always, the Bay County hosts a canine seminar annually. I'm usually one of the instructors.
Okay.
So
sweet, sweet. Do you have a favorite memory with a canine companion?
I have so many, but
give us your top 25.
Top 25, I gotcha. No, so this dog actually saved my dad's life. So like my dad had a traumatic brain injury, went to a concert down in Tampa and fell down the stairs and was in a coma for like a month. He's still recovering. He's doing so much better than the doctors ever said he would. But right when he came home, you know, I wasn't even planning on going over there that day, but I had, you know, I went over and had the dog. And my dad was looking really pale. And so my mom was like moving his legs, and Wahine got up on him and like laid across his legs and would not let us move him. And I was like, hey, I think we need to like go in. Mm-hmm. Turns out his whole leg was pretty much a blood clot. And had we knocked that loose, it would have killed him.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, so like I owe so much. What, like the ESPN thing was awesome, but like this dog saved my dad, you know. So
yeah,
that's like a huge deal for me.
That's amazing. I mean, you hear about, you know how dogs can sense pressure differences and things in different animals with weather and all, but have you looked into like how a dog would be able to sense like a blood clot? I mean, that's amazing to me.
Well, I mean, I've trained quite a bit of service dogs, for like PTSD, for heart conditions, you know, seizure disorders, and like the dogs are able to detect these things like up to like 3 minutes before like any of our medical equipment can. And it's been studied in like Auburn is doing a lot to study like what dogs can actually do and what they're actually capable of. They have a whole like working dog thing where all these doctors get together and say, okay, what do we actually have? And you know, what's so cool is like we have not scratched the surface of what a dog is actually capable of.
Right.
Yeah.
So, and I think that's so cool.
I do too, and that story is absolutely amazing. I mean, the dog, the animal in and of itself, Wahine, is awesome and has proven that over and over again. So what's next for Wahine?
So our next big thing is the Fast Cat Invitational in, I think it was going to be in Orlando, but it just got moved to Ohio, which I'm sort of bummed out about, because Orlando is way cooler.
Yeah, right.
But yeah, so that one is a little bigger. So the Fastest Dogs USA, there was only 22 competitors. And the Ohio one, it's the top five of every single breed.
Oh.
So we're going to be up there for like a whole week, like racing and running dogs.
There you go. Well, we are excited for you over this way. And, man, just really cool stuff. And, again, tell them one more time the best way, the dog trainers, right?
Yep, the dog trainers.
Facebook group or Facebook page?
We have Facebook, Instagram. My website is thedogtrainers.com.
There you go.
All together. And you can get a hold of me in any way.
There you go. Hey, James, do you have anything from Morgan?
Always trust your dog. Yep. Always trust your dog.
There you go. I like that. That was
You know what's so funny? I've got a shirt at home that has trust your dog, and it's backwards, so like, or upside down.
Yeah.
So when you look down, like, you see trust your dog.
Yeah, that's good stuff right there. That is good stuff. This was a lot of fun having you guys on. Congratulations to you and Wahine, and thank you for all that you do with other dogs and with Bay County Search and Rescue, and just for all that you've done up to this point and what you will do in the future. You guys are riding along with the Afternoon Underdogs Hour Number 2 is going to kick off with Steve Barnes, senior writer for TheRebelWalk.com. We'll be right back.
It's the PCB Hobby Takeover with Todd. Mondays at 5:20 on ESPN Northwest Florida.
That is a very high-end card and very rare.
Todd talks about coins, trading cards, collectibles, and the amazing stories behind them.
It was the first one that's ever come through my door.
Plus, we'll be taking your calls and questions at 850-215-6290. The PCB Hobby Takeover.
A platform for you to do your hobby.
Mondays at 5:20 on the Sports Talk Monster. ESPN Northwest Florida.
Good afternoon. This is Joanna with your weather forecast from ESPN Northwest Florida on this Monday. Sunny the rest of the day with a wind out of the south at 11 miles per hour and 75. Tonight look for a calm wind and mostly clear skies with a temperature near 62. Tomorrow, a high around 78 and slightly foggy in the morning but otherwise some sun. Wednesday, hot with a high of 76 and some clouds. This weather forecast is brought to you by Ellis Agency Insurance. Thank you for keeping that dial at ESPN Northwest Florida. Rely on it.
Hi, I'm Tracy, your diamond girl at Tracy's Fine Jewelry. Shopping for the perfect diamond can be difficult, but that's why I've trained my staff to be helpful and to offer you a stress-free diamond experience. Pick your sparkle and use our easy layaway plan. Every woman deserves an exquisite diamond from your diamond girl at Tracy's Fine Jewelry. We don't work on commissions.
We work for smiles and I do's.
So if you're tired of high-pressure salespeople, stop by and see us today at Tracy's Fine Jewelry.
Hey there, employers. Are you in need of reliable and skilled workers to fill your staffing gap? Look no further than Labor Finders, your go-to full-service staffing solution. At Labor Finders, we offer a wide range of skilled, unskilled, and administrative personnel for all your employment needs. Whether it's short-term projects or long-term placements, we've got you covered. Our diverse pool of talent is ready to tackle any job. And guess what? We're always on the lookout for new talent to join our team. Partner with Labor Finders today and experience the difference. Visit our website or contact us now to find your perfect match.
WVLQ Port St. Joe, WGSX Lunan, powered by Panama City Toyota.
ESPN Northwest Florida.
Atlanta Braves baseball is back, and the battle for a seventh straight division title is officially on.
Stretching the pitch. Swung on, lifted left field. That might get out of here. That's in the bullpen. Home run, Sean Murphy.
Tonight, it's a big American League matchup from Minute Maid Park in Houston as Michael Harris and the Braves take on the Houston Astros.
Coverage starts at 6. First pitch, 7:10 tonight on your home for the Atlanta Braves on the Gulf Coast. It's ESPN Northwest Florida.
You're riding shotgun with the Afternoon Underdogs. We're going to need some gas money. The Afternoon Underdogs.
Fill her up, please.
At 104.3 ESPN Northwest Florida.
And it is hour number two of the Afternoon Underdogs right here on ESPN Northwest Florida, 104.3 in Panama City and 101.9 in Port St. Joe. Big shout out to Wahini and Morgan for stopping by. That was a lot of fun. Brian is still trying to figure out the science behind.
It's amazing
how Wahini was able to sniff out the blood clot there, but from Morgan's dad, and wow, just what an amazing story, what an amazing animal, and what an amazing human being Morgan is with doing the training that she does. Now we're going to go to another amazing human being, and Steve Barnes. He is the senior writer for TheRebelWalk.com, and he normally joins us every single Monday to kick off hour number two at 5 p.m. Steve, what is going on, my friend?
Well, a couple sad pieces of news. First, condolences to Coach Steve Sloan, who was the former head coach at Ole Miss and a quarterback at Alabama. He passed away today. And he was kind of the last piece of the bridge between Johnny Vaught to Billy Brewer. Yeah. So people sort of, you know, are enamored with him at Ole Miss. And the second one, the real sad thing, is you got me following a dog?
Yeah, good luck, bud.
Never follow a dog or a child. Come on, man. I got no shot here.
we'll regather and try again next week. But yeah, this, you know, tough shoes to follow, tough act to follow.
Well, the thing that got me most was, you know, when I flipped it on the internet here and I saw him. It's like, wait a second, did they turn into Tennessee fans? They got a little smoky there.
Definitely has a smoky kind of look, but the difference is that I was happy to be in the same room as this dog, so, you know.
Yeah.
Well, it's not bully, it's not juice. So.
That's true.
Man, yeah, how about old Juice? Maybe one of the, might be the most second popular dog behind Miss Peaches right now in the world of sports. But let's also talk about something that was popular, especially for Ole Miss fans. What was your thoughts on the Grove Bowl yesterday afternoon, or Saturday afternoon?
You mean the Grove Bowl games?
Grove Bowl games, that's right.
Well, what they did was they sort of patterned it after the Pro Bowl. You know, it was a win for everybody. The kids loved it because basically they went out there and got to blow some steam and have some fun. Just, you know, having, you know, tug of war, hot dog eating contest, slam dunk contest, stuff like that. The coaches were pretty sure nobody was going to get hurt. The fans got to see the guys play 7-on-7 without their helmets on. So you can actually see their faces like they were, you know, humans instead of a face mask. So I think you're going to see a lot more of that coming next year and the years after that. I watched a few spring games on TV, and this the way I put it in my story for the RebelWalk.com was, man, Baskin-Robbins only has 30 flavors because everybody took vanilla for this.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Bama did a little bit different as far as just having Team Crimson versus Team White. It was Team Offense versus Team Defense in their game. But, yeah, what was your favorite event of all the events?
Well, I kind of like the slam dunk, to tell you the truth, because a local kid, Brandon Turnage, who played at Alabama, then he went to Tennessee for 3 years. Now he's going to finish his career back home in Oxford. He went to Lafayette County High School. He won the dunk contest. The kid's 6'1". Now, it's not a Spud Webb thing, but that was kind of cool. Everybody else had the hot dog eating contest. I was a little disappointed with that one, to tell you the truth. Diego Pounds, an offensive lineman who just came in from North Carolina, 6'6", 330, was only able to eat 3 hot dogs.
How long did they have? Was this a minute and a half?
No, they had a couple of minutes, I think, because Joey Chestnut snuck in there late, and he had 20 in a minute and a half.
That's ridiculous.
To make Diego feel a little better, Jordan Rogers was doing kind of like the sideline commentary for it. He had 3, and he was talking half the time. So I'm not sure where that 3:30 came from, but, you know, Ole Miss is glad to have it.
I mean, I am no college athlete or in shape to be a college athlete right now, but I'm pretty sure I could get three hot dogs down.
I think I could. And, I mean, at best, I mean, I was never a big eater. Oh, but I could eat some hot dogs, and I can eat more popcorn than anybody you've ever met in your life. So I think there's just some foods that are, you know, suited for some people, and Diego's just not a hot dog guy. Yeah. But I tell you what he is. I tell you what, that's a transfer in. He's a protection guy. He transferred from North Carolina. All he did was play left tackle for Drake May. Mm-hmm. Drake May is not getting drafted in a couple of weeks, as high as he is, without Diego Pounds making sure Drake's not on his rear end all Saturdays.
Yep. There you go, Joey Chestnut coming to the game. Wow, that's pretty cool stuff. And you think that other teams in the future will mirror this to some extent?
Oh, yes. You're not getting anything really out of a spring game. I watched part of Georgia, Tennessee, Arkansas, and Florida. And, I mean, even Carson Beck said, it's like, well, we didn't show anything on offense. They didn't show anything on defense. And the crowd was leaving in the third quarter. It's like, okay, well, this is, you know, at least 7-on-7 at Ole Miss. It looked a little better. Like I said, you could actually see them as human beings. They weren't wearing jerseys. They were wearing T-shirts with a number on it. But you could see them as they are instead of these, you know, 300-pound behemoths walking around in pads and all this tape on.
Yeah, and that also helps with their, not that they need it, but, you know, kind of the camaraderie with fellow students there as well, being able to see them.
You should have seen it when the fraternity and sororities got to do the tug-of-war and the hot dog eating contest. In fact, the hot dog eating contest was won, well, besides Chestnut, it was won by a fraternity guy. And then at the end of the sorority's tug-of-war, Jonathan Hess, a former tight end who was going to compete on The Bachelor this fall, he took on the sorority, and they pulled him over the line in like 3 seconds.
Wow.
I mean, that's the kind of, I mean, you're not going to interact with football players like that. And when they did that, I mean, each team surrounded the little area where they did the tug of war. Each team just went and just started, you know, hugging the sorority kids. It's like, yeah, you killed him. You don't find that at other campuses.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you're.
And Joey Chestnut, by the way, got to throw out the first pitch at the baseball game that night.
That reminds me of Gronk today. He was the grand marshal at the Boston Marathon, and then he threw out the first pitch for the Boston Red Sox game, and instead of throwing it to the plate, he just threw it directly at his feet right there and had the infamous spike.
Gronk threw out that pitch. Red Sox got killed.
Yep.
Joey Chestnut threw out the first pitch. Ole Miss comes back and win in 12 innings.
Ooh, yeah, you got Brian Seathen over here, so I'll say one more thing about the Grove Bowl games, and then we'll get into baseball. But Phil Still said, I don't know if you saw this on Twitter or not, he said, just watched the Ole Miss spring game, got very little out of it. Dunk contest, tug of war, hot dog eating contest, obstacle course, no pads during 7-on-7 flag football game, 50-yard field, not worth watching, don't waste your time. What would your response be to Phil Still?
I watched Georgia, watched Arkansas, watched Florida. Got nothing out of that either.
Yeah.
They had pads on, but they didn't want to hit each other. And
that's a good point.
If a wide receiver got a step on a defensive back, the defensive back just sort of stopped. At least in this one, people say, you know, 7-on-7, they're, you know, the quarterback's not being rushed. Well, also that there's no threat for a run game, so the linebackers were dropping back deeper and cutting off the throwing lanes. And I think the best throw of the day was Austin Simmons, the third-string guy. And A.J. Maddox, by the way, the fourth-string guy, did pretty well too. But Maddox, he stood that back there like a statue. Then he started moving around, and he threw between three defenders and hit Wade in the end zone. It's like, how did that ball get through there? And Tom Hart was doing, I guess, play-by-play, is how you'd have to say it. He's a play-by-play guy. He's like, you know, I saw where he was throwing it. And there's no way that ball gets there, but it got there. So, yeah, you are getting a little bit out of it.
There you go. Well, off to baseball now. Let's talk a little bit about the weekend that Ole Miss had.
No, let's keep
baseball.
Talking about hot dogs.
Well, I tell you, I'm actually interested in Brian's opinion on this one. The Saturday night game, the kid who hit the home run for State keeps the bat halfway down the first baseline, then does, let's just say, an animated bat flip toward the Ole Miss dugout, and didn't get thrown out. Now, Bianco, the coach at Ole Miss, goes out to say, hey, you got to throw him out for that. And what happened? They threw Bianco out.
Of course
so
they did.
I mean, Brian, did you think that was a little bit, you know, too much, you know, pardon the pun, hot-dogging?
Yeah. I don't like that stuff in general. I've got a few issues with... There's a fine line between having an edge and being over the top. And there have been a couple issues this year that I haven't liked with the State players. I didn't like the catcher kneeing the guy in the ribs against Georgia that caused 11 people to get ejected, which was kind of ridiculous. But there have been some things like that I don't like. No, if I were Lamonis, I would have walked out there and said, kick him out of the game or I'm going to pull him. I've never liked that stuff. And you saw what happened, Steve. It fires up Ole Miss. Not just the bat flip thing, but then Bianco getting thrown out. State blows a huge lead, loses to Ole Miss in extras, and then the die is cast for Sunday. Now you've lost the series. I think it was complete self-inflicted wounds, and it's terrible.
Well, kudos to Lamonis because he suspended the kid for Sunday.
So like, good.
You're not playing
tomorrow. That's right. That's right.
So, you know, kudos to that. So, and speaking of coaches, Bianco got thrown out, but he got the win. He got the win on Sunday. He needs one more for his 1,000th in his career. And they play at Arkansas State tomorrow. And then this weekend they have to travel to Georgia, and they're ranked number 22.
Right.
So please get it Tuesday, just in case.
Right. But, yeah, Saturday hurt because I knew losing the game like that after having the lead, I kind of just knew what was going to happen Sunday. Now, I didn't think they'd get run ruled in the seventh, but but I did think and you see that when momentum shifts like that, it's hard to come back the next day. And
Ole Miss is a team of streaks. They started 2-4. Then they won 16 out of 20.
Mm-hmm.
Then going into Saturday, they were 0-7 or 0-8. Going into Saturday. Now they come back in extras and win that one on a walk-off. I hate when they call it a walk-off in a run rule game.
Right.
But Furness hit the home run. That gave them enough to say, okay, this one's over. It's sort of, you know, if Ole Miss can get on a little streak here, you know, they're still, right, if the season ended right now, it's going to be LSU and Auburn left out of the conference tournament. If Ole Miss can put a little distance between those two teams, then I think State and Ole Miss are going to be back in the SEC tournament for the first time in, what, 3 or 4 years?
Yeah, State hasn't been since they won the national championship, and then Ole Miss last year. So, yeah, it's crazy.
And the funny thing is, you know, it's a football conference. It's a football conference. Top four teams this week in the D1 baseball rankings are all in the SEC.
Yeah.
What are we making of Kentucky season?
I tell you what, Kentucky, I can't believe they're ranked third. I thought I would rank them ahead of Arkansas after last week, even though Arkansas's got 30 wins.
Yeah.
But we're going to find out more this week. Kentucky and Tennessee play a three-game set. Mm. Kentucky, and it's in Lexington. Kentucky's 29-5, 13-1 in the SEC. Tennessee's 30-6, 10-5 in the SEC.
Yeah, that one's going to be a good. Where is that one being played at? Kentucky or Tennessee?
In Lexington.
Yeah. So both of those teams really good at the house, but Kentucky's a lot better. They've also played more games on the road than what Tennessee has as well. I'm very interested in that now, Steve. And Tennessee riding a 6-game win streak as well.
Well, this is kind of a fratricide thing, like Condoleezza Rice said about SEC football. If you look at it, Kentucky has 29 wins, Tennessee 30, Vanderbilt 26, South Carolina 25, UGA 27. In the West, Arkansas is 30. A&M, number one team this week, 32. State's got 22. Bama's got 24. Ole Miss has 20. LSU has 22. And they're in danger of not making the conference tournament.
And what's amazing is if LSU misses the conference tournament, they would be the third consecutive national champion to miss the SEC tournament the following year.
Well, let me ask you guys both something right there. Is it worth it to miss the SEC tournament the year following a College World Series?
No.
I mean, look, the national championship was phenomenal. It's the only one in Mississippi State history.
Right.
You still don't want to miss your conference tournament because that means you're either 13th or 14th in the conference.
I don't know. As an Alabama fan, like, if you were to say, hey, you're going to miss the SEC tournament next year, but this year you're going to win the whole thing, I'd be like, all right, absolutely. Like, let's go.
Now, I may be in the minority on that, but one of my things I was always the most proud about Mississippi State baseball is we were great every year.
Yeah.
At some level, and that's what I enjoyed. And then occasionally we would have a shot at the national championship. I don't like, you see it in basketball, you can literally mortgage everything on one year and this, that, or the other, and then you just stink for the next 12. And, you know, the magazines and the shirts and the hats that you buy to me aren't worth it. I want to be competitive every year, and we may not win it every year, but I have hated the last 2 years more than I love the year that we won it.
Hmm.
Brian, you're not in the minority there if I have a vote. So let me ask Dave this. You're a Bama fan. You can have the national championship this year, but you have to go sub 500 for the next 5 years. Is it worth it?
In baseball.
Oh, in football.
Oh, in football. You know what? For the run that they've had, and we're going sub 500, and it's not saving anymore. So, is it worth it? No. No, I would say no, but that's also, I don't know, a little bit, I feel like I can deal a little bit differently with college baseball than I can with football.
I tell you something, the cardiac units in the hospital in the state of Alabama could not handle 5 years of sub-500. No. I can tell you that right now.
UAB would have to, like, throw patients out to bring in new beds.
I mean, they would have triage in the parking lot that would stretch for miles.
The question is how many head coaches, like, what number of head coach would we be on at that point?
Five?
Gotta be seven.
I think one of the three of us would probably get an interview after that.
That's right.
You tag them right about that.
I'm very serious about that. It consistency of program and always being competitive is more important to me than a one off and then just, you know, stinking for the next several years. It just is. And I love that national championship. It was so much. I rung a cowbell in my house by myself. That's how much I love that national championship. But like I said, I have hated the last 2 years more. Because we should always be in the NCAA tournament. Maybe not always to Omaha, but we should always be in the tournament. It was. I can't even describe, like, how wrong the world seemed the last 2 years.
Yeah. But, man, I'm going back with that question of you know, national championship and then the next 5 years or sub 500. Well, growing up, like, I was not an Alabama fan because they were good. I was an Alabama fan because my dad was an Alabama fan, you know? So it's like I suffered through a lot, and I remember when they finally won the first one, I was like, oh, this is what it's like, and never in a million years would have dreamed that it was going to turn into what it did turn into. And
sure.
So by that fact, you know, I'm not one of those spoiled fans who's just like, oh, we got to win every year. I think after the first, you know, three championships that Saban brought back, it's like, all right, you know, this can't continue to happen that much longer, right? Reality's got to set in.
Back to baseball here.
Right.
Sometime, I think it's about 3 weeks from now, the captain from Ole Miss's national championship team, Tim Elko, who now is in double-A with Birmingham, is going to be in Pensacola playing the Blue Wahoo.
Okay.
And I'm going to go down and talk to him. And I'll guarantee you right now, he is not going to talk about that national championship. He's going to talk about this year's team.
Mm-hmm.
How come we're not doing this? How come we're not doing that?
Yeah.
If you watch some of those ESPN 30 for 30s, you watch the one about the U, you watch the one about the Pony Express with SMU, all the players who are winning all those things, when the team went down, they weren't talking about the championship. They're talking about, what do we have to do to get back up here?
Yeah. And look, it's, and Steve knows this as well as anything with the state of Mississippi, but particularly with Mississippi State. Look, we've been to the SEC championship in football. We lost it, but we went. We've been to the Final Four. I was in school when we did that. But baseball is the identity of Mississippi State athletics. It is. It is every bit the identity the way football is for Alabama, the way basketball is for Kentucky. And it is a significant sense of pride that I may not have grown up with, but I certainly picked up once I was there. And everything is about being competitive and being a program that is always in the mix. And that's just the identity of a Mississippi State sports fan. We used to have a chant going when we were 3-8 in footballs. Wait till baseball season. Wait till baseball season. I mean, that's how much it means.
When did y'all start chanting? Wait till 2022 and we'll finally be champion. Yeah.
Wasn't that?
Well, the thing that gets me is everybody's saying Ole Miss is putting everything into football this year because this is your chance to get it. Because if you don't get it this year, you're never going to get it. How many Ole Miss fans would take one national championship in their lifetime to, like, go to the Independence Bowl the rest of their lives? I think a lot of them would in this situation. And, I mean, to tell you the truth, I almost would, because the last time they won one was before I was born.
And that's what I'm saying back to baseball is with if someone were to say you get a national championship this year, but the next, you could say even the next three seasons, you're not going to make the SEC tournament. I'm like, well, I'm going to make sure to watch every single pitch that I can this year. But, yeah, I'm right there with you, Steve. And it's going to be interesting to watch Ole Miss this year as it has.
The thing is, I heard a podcast. I put it in the story. This guy, let's just say he is not from the South. That's being gentle. And he said, Ole Miss is a middle-of-the-pack SEC team. They don't have any depth. Okay, Ole Miss not having depth this year is kind of like saying the Gulf of Mexico is just damp.
That's right.
You've got four quarterbacks. You've got six wide receivers, and Juice Wells didn't even play in the spring. You've got 3.5 starting offensive linemen. Then you bring in two from Washington. You bring in the kid from North Carolina. You bring in one from Southern Miss even. So you got all that. Then on defense, you brought in everything that you need. The kicker and the punter come back. The only thing that could possibly be lacking is the running back room, because Bentley was hurt all spring, so he's walking around in a boot. But you still have Kedrick Briscano. The kid transferred in from LSU. He had knee surgery. And this is something like about Kiffin. He said, well, that was a pretty serious surgery, serious rehab. We hope to get him back to the playoffs. So I like the confidence there. But you could use a little room, and guess what? Portal opens up tomorrow.
Yeah, and I wish we had more time to talk about that, but we don't, Steve. We are out of time, my man. But thanks again for your time, and we look forward to chatting with you next week about what's been going on in the transfer portal.
All right, Brian, let's both go to Hoover this year, State and Ole Miss.
Sounds good to me, and I might even be up there myself to watch it.
All righty, brother.
There you go.
All right, that's Steve Barnes, senior writer for TheRebelWalk.com. Coming up next, it's the PCB Hobby Takeover with Todd Mueller. We'll be right back.
ESPN Northwest Florida presents
Wrestling Against Cancer, number 9.
Saturday, April 27th at Bay Haven Charter Academy. In the main event, it's a tag team showdown with Exodus versus Mike Steele and Mr. 850. Plus exciting women's wrestling. Tickets still just $12. Ages 6 to 17, only $8. 5 and under, free.
More information, ESPNPC.com.
Good evening. This is Joanna on ESPN Northwest Florida with your weather forecast on this Monday. Mostly clear tonight with a very light wind and temps near 62. We will have some sun and slight fog and wind speed of 6 miles per hour tomorrow morning and be very warm at 76. And partly sunny in the afternoon and evening and a high 78. Some clouds Wednesday with a temp of 77. This forecast is sponsored by Mid-South Lumber, the best little lumberyard in Panama City. Thank you for keeping that dial at ESPN Northwest Florida. Rely on it.
The road is
yours. So let your spring adventures begin and discover the new Kia at Bill Byrd Kia. Stop by today and check out our 2024 SUV family and take a test drive. See all the new features that elevate any adventure. Now offering 4.75% APR for up to 48 months on the purchase of a new 2024 Kia Sorento EX. That rugged good look with luxury and the perfect balance of comfort, safety, and technology. Bill Byrd Kia, the home of the 20-year, 200,000-mile warranty. Stop by anytime and see us at 2435 East 15th Street or anytime at BillByrdKiaPanamaCity.com. We'll give you the peace of mind that you can trust.
Offer from Kia Finance America for the purchase of a new 2024 Kia Sorento EX with $2,294 per month per 1,000 finance and 48 months. Quantities limited. No down payment required. Can I be combined with other finance offers? The 20-year, 200,000-mile warranty is available. Bill Byrd Kia warranty. See dealer for complete details. Offer for well-qualified buyers. Must take delivery from dealer stock through 4/30/24.
He likes to lift weights in a parking lot and eat Weight Gainer 3000.
I'm really starting to feel out nasty.
David Hayes is part of the Afternoon Underdogs on ESPN Northwest Florida.
We are back. This is the PCB Hobby Takeover with the owner, Todd Mueller. Don't forget the Atlanta Braves start tonight, 6 o'clock, and the first pitch is at 7:10. PCB Hobby is a sponsor of your Atlanta Braves right here on ESPN Northwest Florida. Do you got a good story from the shop for this week, Todd?
Oh, my gosh. How many stories don't I have? I don't have anything real specific this week. We have bought some more collections, so that's good. People are bringing stuff in. I did want to do a shout-out. I mentioned that we had gotten a Tom Brady autograph patch card in, mm-hmm. and somebody heard us on the radio, and it's by. ESPN Radio, they were listening to it, and they came in the shop and bought it.
Let's go, yeah, dude.
Here, here comes Randy for the commission.
Yeah. Right. How about that, though? That's cool.
Yeah, it was really cool. So that was awesome. But other than that, you know, I got some normal boilerplate stuff. One of the biggest things that we got going on right now is our in TCG. We have the new Magic the Gathering Outlaws of Thunder Junction, and we did our pre-release party on Friday. We had 46 players. Players. Not people.
That's
players.
Not, yeah, because they probably
because brought, on top of yeah. it, there was other people there. So it was the most packed we've ever been. It was fantastic. Anyways, a lot of them dressed up in cowboy suits and cowboy, you know, gear. So it was really cool. They took a big picture and everything. And so that was really neat. I just want to tell everybody thank you for that. We really appreciate you guys showing up. That was a lot of fun.
There you go, man.
So with that having been said, Outlaws of Thunder Junction for Magic the Gathering is out. We have a bunch of it. So, of course, on the other front, this weekend, the Topps buyback program kicked off because Alex
Pereira.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Alex Pereira won.
Oh, yeah.
And so he is the buyback. Yeah, whooped him. So he is the buyback. You have till June 30th to bring your buyback cards in. We have a list, and I believe the base is
$20. Yeah,
so
and it's actually 20, picked up a few today.
It's 20 and up. Yeah. 20 and up. So so bring in your Alex cards so you can get that. And then, of course, we have some very exciting comic book news. So while we don't have many stories that went on in the shop, we do have one awesome thing. Our first comic book has arrived that we were a part of. We are not on the back cover, but we were an investor in it. And it's called it's by a company called IDW. It's a publishing company, and it's Beneath the Trees Where No One Sees, number one, Where the Wild Things Are, by Kyle Willis. So it's a variant comic book. So if you're into comic books, you need to come by and pick one up. We've got them for sale at the shop and on our website. And we're going to have graded ones, autographed ones, and then, of course, just base ones. So we've sold several on our website and eBay already. Those will be going and being shipped out soon. But we're just very excited. It's kind of a feather in our cap for the very first time we have it. We're involved in a comic book.
That's awesome. How was that whole process?
It was great. Kyle's been really great. He's a great artist and a lot of fun to work with. And it was a lot of fun to talk about it and see the cover for the first time. And then, of course, get our books today. So they just came in today. So we were super stoked about that. So anyways, so that's going on. Of course, typical, we're always buying. We need you guys to bring your coins, your cards, your comic books, you know, your TCGs, everything in. We're doling out the money left and right for collections. So keep it coming, guys. Keep it coming. And of course, we've been still doing a ton of streaming. You can catch us on Whatnot pretty much every day of the week. You can catch us on eBay Live under PCB Hobby any day of the week. We've always got stuff going on, streaming coins, you know, doing deals, all that kind of stuff. So make sure that everybody checks that out. Other than that, we do have some new sports card releases this week, and I'm going to have Brian go over that.
Yeah, so basketball really heating up, which is a little awkward because we're about to go into the playoffs here, and now a lot of the products are starting to roll out. But one of my favorite personal ones is out right now, and that's Origins Basketball. Absolutely gorgeous cards, a little thicker stock, very colorful, a lot of some of the first on-card autos, autographs that players are going to have. Are in Origins Basketball. So that is out. It's, I believe, only the fifth 23-24 product that's out, but you're going to start seeing several over the next month to 6 weeks.
Right.
Topps Chrome Black Baseball. To give an example of how Topps is now caught up in the schedule, 2023 Chrome Black Baseball came out about 3.5 months ago. And now we've got 2024 out on schedule, early season. So it's a very good product. They always do a couple of base cards, beautiful matte finish. And then there's always an encased autograph card that's already in a case. Mm-hmm. And they'll, you know, vary from the hot rookies of the day to a lot of big name veterans. So it's really cool product. So Topps Chrome Black Baseball drops this Wednesday. And then there's two hockey products out. Upper Deck Black Diamond, which is, I don't do a whole lot of hockey collecting anymore, but Black Diamond is one that I do because it kind of amalgamates a bunch of different premium sets together.
Well, Black Diamond's been out since
right.
the year 2000, I believe. That was even 98, I think, they did Black Diamond.
Yeah.
And it's, I mean, that's 26 years of Upper Deck running those series of cards. Mm-hmm.
And what they do now is they'll have their Black Diamond cards in it, but they'll also have cards from Exquisite and cards mm-hmm. from Status and things like that that
right.
will come in there and join it. So it's a higher-end product, but it's absolutely gorgeous. And then, of course, we're following on with the hype. Upper Deck releasing the Connor Bedard collection this week. So obviously he's been probably the hottest thing in hockey. McDavid... probably not quite to the same level. McDavid has since become even bigger, probably since Crosby.
Right.
I think, yeah. as far as yeah. hype. So it's been wonderful. We've had a lot of people jump into hockey because of Connor Bedard.
Mm-hmm.
And so they're putting out the Connor Bedard collection here, which will be just a lot of different cards featuring him, which is wonderful. So a lot going on. And then the big one to me, first week of May, Bowman Baseball, and we've gotten a preview of it, and it looks phenomenal. They also have retrofractors. They always throw in a couple of guys, you know, from the past, and this year's retrofractors are going to be Bob Gibson and Pete Rose.
Oh,
so here we go.
Here we go.
Oh,
okay. So I did actually have something else to tell everybody, the changing gears for a second. If you haven't been watching Metals, Spot has gone nuts on silver and gold.
Yeah.
Silver Spot is up to $28.88 an ounce, and Spot
that's
Gold...
that's like $3 from last week.
$3 from last week.
Yeah,
right.
It's amazing.
And $2,386 for an ounce of gold. So if you have any metals, you have any scrap gold, you have any bullion, and you need a little extra cash for the summer trips or whatever, come on down and let us buy it because the price is high.
See, this is what's wrong with me. I got in from a six and a half hour drive last night. I look at Spot, and I see how crazy silver and gold has gotten. And then I watch the first episode of Fallout.
Oh yeah,
that's what he's talking about. That.
And I'm like, I mean, I'm like trying to crawl under things now. I think the world is ending based on all of these things.
Now, did you play the video game?
No.
Somebody asked that today.
Yeah.
Who did they ask? Somebody asked if they played Fallout. Anyways, but
you
want
to know about it?
What's that?
What do you want to know about it?
Exactly. but that series, apparently there's a series out on. I have not
thoroughly enjoyed the first episode.
Bill said that that he's watching it.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool. Anyways. So spot gold and silver are way up. So if you have some extra stuff, I would recommend bringing it in. Now is the time. Don't miss the plunge upward.
That's right.
Anyways.
Plus, I mean, the closer we get to the election, it seems like every four years.
It's going to be tumultuous this year. It just is. Yeah. It's a little crazy out there. Let's call it what it is. I'm not one of those guys that's like, oh, my God, we're going to be trading silver in the streets. But, you know, it is going to be pretty tumultuous, I think, this year. So we look forward to it, though, and super excited. Things are going really good at the shop. Like I said, we've had our Super Saturday last Saturday. That was a lot of fun. Had a good amount of people come in. And then, of course, Saturday night, I think they ran another Outlaws Magic the Gathering, and then, of course, had some other different things going on. So that was pretty cool. And, of course, we were streaming and stuff like that. So it was good. But it's been busy. We got a lot of singles, a lot of stuff going on. And we just urge everybody to come on by. I know it's getting a little busy with the traffic out there, but I think it's still a really good time to come by if you're local.
Well, and starting to get other things. Like, went through a lot of autographed jerseys recently. Mm-hmm. There's some, like, boxes where it's kind of a mystery. You buy it and you end up with that. I think they got some mini helmets coming in here soon. So a lot of, not just cards and everything that people love, but also delving into some, starting to, now with the shop being expanded, got room, can start getting into some of the memorabilia pieces.
Yeah, absolutely. Too. So it's pretty cool. Yeah. So anyways, we've had several new hires, so that's good. Some new streamers and new people involved. I want to give a shout out to our boy Big Kern, is what we call him. His name's Chris, and he just got added to the comic book team. He is a through-and-through streamer, and he is a walking encyclopedia of comic books.
There you go.
That's crazy. We also have another gentleman that's going to be coming on board at the end of this month who is going to be a coin streamer, better known as Homeschool Tim. That's his handle.
What school did he go to?
Exactly. I'm pretty sure he was homeschooled. No, just kidding.
I was homeschooled till 10th grade.
Yeah, I can tell. Anyways, wow. Just joking. Anyways, so we got a lot of different stuff going on. Pretty exciting. Stuff in the pipe for sure, but I'll have more information for new things next week, of course. Other than that, that's what's going on at the shop.
How long should you hold on to a collectible coin before selling?
So it really here's what the problem is, and I have a long statement about this, but we'll keep it as short as possible. In the end, if you are spending money on something, let's just call it a collectible and call it a coin, and you're spending money on it, that better be money that you don't want to touch ever. So let's say you're an 18-year-old and you don't even live on your own yet. You still live at mom and dad's, and you're working your buns off, and you got a little extra money, and you're like, I love collecting coins. I'm going to put it into coins. And then someday you're going to get, you want to buy a house, and you need some funds. And you're like, okay, well, I think I'm going to sell my stuff off. There was no reason to ever buy that coin, really. Why don't you just save the money and then go get your place and do what you need to do? You know, that's my opinion on it. So I'm the type that says do not put money into metals specifically and really anything collectible unless you're wanting to save it for the value to go up. Because let's be real, all the stories we ever hear about somebody getting so lucky and having this or having that is because they had something for 50 years.
Yeah.
So start young, put money into it, don't touch it. That's the best I can say about it. I mean, it is what it is. You know, I did the same thing. I started collecting when I was 9, and I still have some of those coins.
Yeah.
You know, you wait, you hold, you know, and don't put your money into things that you're going to have to get your money right back out of because you're never going to win.
Mm-hmm.
Now, with that having been said, be smart about collectibles too. Sometimes you hit a home run on something. Go ahead and take the money.
Yeah.
Put it into something else and invest in that for a while. You know, take your home run. You know, because it can happen for sure.
Absolutely.
So that's my opinion.
And then who was it that made the cookies and cream what are those called?
Macaroons? Kate.
Macaroons. Oh, yeah.
Got to give her a shout out.
Thank you, Kate, for spreading diabetes all over Bay County.
Appreciate that. Have a doctor's appointment on Thursday. Good. It's all your fault.
They're so good.
Yeah. Anyways, but so that's my two cents on it.
There we go. Well, Todd, thank you so much for stopping by. We know you got to get out of here, so we'll go ahead and let you go, and we'll have you back next Monday for the PCB Hobby Takeover.
Appreciate it.
All right, that's Todd Mueller. This is the Afternoon Underdogs on ESPN Northwest Florida. Quick timeout. We'll be right back.
America's team plays here.
And a rocket to right field. This thing is into orbit.
The Atlanta Braves on ESPN Northwest Florida. Acuna, Ozzy, and Austin Riley lead the Braves' high-powered offense.
Swung on, belted, deep right field. Get out of here, Ozzy. Home run. Ball game.
The Atlanta Braves on ESPN Northwest Florida is sponsored by Brock's Pest Control, Store More Portable Buildings, Reliable Hydraulic Solutions, Billberg Kia, and Mid-South Lumber.
Give me a break. Give me a break. Break me off a piece of that Kit Kat donut. For a limited time, enjoy the Kit Kat Donut Collection at Krispy Kreme Donuts. Choose from the Kit Kat Salted Caramel Brownie or the Kit Kat Cookie Dream. And break off a piece of that Kit Kat Crunch Donut. So give yourself a break with the Kit Kat Donut Collection only at Krispy Kreme Donuts. Next to Gulf Coast Hospital, 23rd Street, Panama City, and the Ross Clark Circle in Dothan.
Ready to save big on the number one selling car brand in the world?
We've extended our best deals of the year throughout the month of April. Get 2.99% APR plus 90 days until you make your first payment on a new Camry. Get 2.99% on the sporty Corolla. Ready for 2.99% on a new RAV4? And get 2.99% on the tough Tundra.
Wherever life leads, there's a Toyota for you. Right here at Panama City Toyota.
Offer expires April 30th. For details, visit PanamaCityToyota.com.
If you spend any time at all in your yard, you're going to encounter fire ants.
We know they can ruin a party. That's why we're this area's experts at fire ant elimination.
As your certified top choice professional, we will rid your yard of these unwanted invaders. Brock Pest is so sure they'll get rid of fire ants that they offer a one-year guarantee.
Enjoy your yard fire ant free. We guarantee it. Give us a call for your free consultation.
Brock Lawn and Pest Control. Our family protecting yours since 1968.
Now back to the Afternoon Underdogs.
This 53-man roster is stupid.
Where it's halftime all the time.
Raise the rosters, you cheapskate owners, and get that done now.
The Afternoon Underdogs.
ESPN Northwest Florida.
And we are back. This is the Afternoon Underdogs. You're tuned in to ESPN Northwest Florida. Atlanta Braves coming up. First pitch tonight, 7:10. Coverage starts at 6 o'clock right after the Afternoon Underdogs. Houston Astros, Atlanta Braves. Who is it that's going for the Braves tonight? Darius Vines is going for the Bravos tonight. I believe he only had a couple of games started last year. A few of them, actually. He had two games started. Played in five games last year. Threw for 20 innings. Gave up 15 hits. 10 runs, 9 of those being earned, 3 home runs, 7 walks, and 14 strikeouts. Going up against that kind of struggling Houston Astros offense, and the Astros are going to have Spencer Arrighetti on the bump for them tonight. He is 0-1 to this point of the season. Got his major league debut against the Royals last week. The Royals won that game 11-2. Spencer went for 3 innings, gave up 7 runs on 7 hits, 3 walks and 3 strikeouts, but did not allow any home runs. So we'll see how that Braves offense fares tonight. Do not want to fall to 9-6, but again, very early in the season at this point. We'll see how the night goes for Darius Vines and the Atlanta Braves. The Braves are the betting favorite tonight at -120. All right, and Wrestling Against Cancer 9, that is going to be April 27th at Bay Haven Charter Academy. I'm going to be doing the ring announcing that evening, so come out, check it out. Jaden's medical expenses are what we're doing this for. All proceeds go to help out Jaden and his medical expenses. Tickets are $12. Kids 6 and through 17 get in for $8. 5 and under get in free with a paid adult. The doors will open at 5:30 and the bell time at 6:30. We'll have a few of the wrestlers on Friday, April 26th, ahead of that show. And also, there's going to be a former WCW wrestler and WWE referee, Scott Armstrong, there as well. So that's going to be a great evening. How was the Raw after WrestleMania?
Crazy. Lot going on. The Rock basically showed up and got in Cody's face a little bit and basically told him, I'm going to be going away for a while because he's got to do the Hollywood thing. But they're clearly setting up something for the summer, I think, with The Rock and Cody Rhodes. So that was good. They're starting new storylines. They ended so many at WrestleMania, they've got to create new ones. But they did it in a really entertaining way. And then this past Friday on SmackDown, Solo Sikoa kind of took the reins, if you will, no pun intended, of the Bloodline and brought in a new member of the Bloodline. He's a guy named Tama Tonga. He's actually, for those of you who were wrestling fans back in the late 80s, all through the 90s, he is the son of Haku.
Okay.
Or Meng in WCW, Haku in the WWF at the time. So all part of the same family. So Tama Tonga, who was long hoped to be coming to WWE, is now in there and is a member of the Bloodline. And they jumped Jimmy Uso and basically threw him out. So going to be interesting storylines going forward with this. But they've done a pretty good job after buttoning up so many stories to start several new ones. There is one item of worry, though. It's being reported, we're going to find out tonight if this is true or not, that Rhea Ripley may have sustained an injury during last Monday's Raw, and it could be as serious as she may have to vacate the title. So that's my tease for watching Raw tonight, because they may address it tonight. We'll have to see.
Wow. How about a little buy, sell, or hold action
real quick here?
Just Jackson Holliday, man. He we teased that earlier, so we can't get all the way away from it, even though we normally do get all the way away from things that we say we're going to talk about. But Jackson Holliday, do you buy, sell, or hold him in the sports card world?
You may have missed the absolute height of the market. That would have been probably right the instant he got called up. But I always am a big fan of selling when it's hot. And right now, it's as hot. When a guy gets called up, their stuff goes through the roof. Now, Holiday had been pushed pretty high in the preseason because everybody thought he was going to get called up. His stuff dropped off pretty hard when he didn't. So that was an excellent buying opportunity. And right now, I would sell, because unless he goes on like just an absolutely freak tear as a rookie, you're going to be able to buy it back cheaper in 6 weeks to 2 months. So I would sell now and then maybe buy it back later, because I do think he's going to be a good long-term prospect. It's the same advice I gave on Wyatt Langford several weeks back.
Right.
I had a nice high-end Wyatt Langford that I loved. I sold it because I know I will get that same card back for $150 cheaper in about 2 months if I want to.
Yeah.
So you take advantage of the opportunity. So when guys get called up, I'm moving them right then. So.
Hey, were you surprised that he got called up as early as he did, or were you more surprised that they didn't start the season off with him on the roster?
That, I think it would have been better for him in general, like we talked about earlier. I was surprised, but then again, they've got some bottlenecks with the O's, and I think they wanted to see how their current roster looked starting the season, and they didn't get off to a torrid start, and they had some issues, and so they decided, nah, let's go on and bring him up. I figured with a guy like Holiday, who is clearly not someone, look, some of their prospects, they're going to want to shop them. And go get some pitching and things like that with him. Holiday is clearly a guy you want to hold on to. So I thought going and give him the nod, get him on the roster, much the way the Brewers did kind of with Churio, you know, like that. So I was a little surprised that they came back around so quickly. You know, I thought maybe it'd be like a Dominguez situation last year where everybody expected the Yankees to call him up. They didn't, and they didn't bring him up until kind of cleanup time at the end of the year when you do that. And of course then he got injured, unfortunately. But so I don't know, that's my long-winded way of saying I thought they were going to bring him up to start the season, But I was very surprised they called him up so soon after sending him down.
Yeah, I'm right there with you. And they were having, man, they were having a lot of fun over there in Norfolk.
Oh, that's
the
truth.
The Tides, man, just putting up a lot of runs in that game. On this day real quick here, 1910, William Howard Taft is the first U.S. president to throw out the first ball, the first pitch at a baseball game. 1927, Yankee slugger Babe Ruth hits the first of his MLB record season, 60 home runs, tees off on the A's Howard Emke in the first inning of New York's 6-3 win over Philadelphia. 1947, Jackie Robinson. Here today is Jackie Robinson Day. He became the first African-American to play in U.S. Major League Baseball for the Brooklyn Dodgers. And then in 1965, the NFL changes the penalty flag from white to bright gold. I'm sure that I missed a lot today, James. I think that I got a little ADD, a little sidetracked after the 1965 one.
Only got two more for you. This day, 1997, baseball honors Jackie Robinson by retiring his number 42. Only one more player would continue wearing that jersey, and nobody else has worn it since Mariano Rivera stopped wearing it. And I'll end on this one. This day, 2000, Cal Ripken Jr. becomes the 24th player to reach 3,000 hits. And he is, let's see, one of a few that seven players that have 3,000 hits and 400 home runs.
Wow. Yeah, we talked earlier about Gronk throwing out the first pitch or the first spike today for the Boston Red Sox. The Guardians got the better of the Red Sox, as Steve alluded to earlier. 6-0 underway. You've got a few games right now. Rangers are on the road playing the Detroit Tigers. They're in the bottom of the first. Tie game between the Giants and the Marlins in Miami, also in the bottom of the first. And the Rockies and the Phillies, which the Rockies have had some surprising wins, some not-so-surprising losses as well. But Rockies and the Phillies in Philadelphia. What are your guys' thoughts on the Philadelphia Phillies City Connect jerseys? Have you seen them yet?
I saw pictures. I saw the hype for them. Look, I'm the old fuddy-duddy. I'm not a big City Connect kind of guy. As they go, these weren't bad. I know they're getting a lot of good reviews. I thought they were fine. And from me, that's probably high praise.
Yeah,
so,
yeah. If you're saying something nice about jerseys, especially something that's a little bit more modern.
I think the unfortunate thing is they're tied to the Philadelphia Phillies.
Yeah, there you go.
That's personal.
It's not like get off my lawn. It's more like, all right, you could take one or two steps in the lawn, but that'll be enough right there, all right? Stop right there, you young whippersnapper. All right, what about you, James? What are you thinking of the Philadelphia Phillies unis?
I've seen them for the first time. And I'm not quite understanding. I'm getting a two-tone Titan blue with it.
Okay.
I mean, I get it. The Phillies, like most every other Major League Baseball team in the 80s, had the baby powder blues. Mm. So, I mean, it kind of makes sense. But just the blue on blue with the yellow for the names, it just doesn't ring Philly or Phillies to me.
Well, back before the Eagles were green and white, they were actually that kind of like a baby powder blue and yellow. So there is that. I don't know how I can necessarily, you know, make the ties of the colors of the city of Philadelphia and what their jerseys are. Now, I was talking to Caveman Rick the other day, and I was like, man, I really like them because they're kind of like the only thing like that in baseball. Not only do you have that kind of gradient from light blue, from powder blue to like a dark blue to black, but that, you know, those three colors, the powder blue, the kind of royal blue, black, and yellow, so four colors, no one else has got that. But then the Mariner City Connect are very similar to that. I saw that later that evening, so I was like, well, that makes them a little less cool. I don't know. I'm a fan of them, though. I'll say that they're one of the better City Connects out there. And I think that baseball is doing a good job with the City Connects as well. Now, I don't want to see us get into like the likes of the NBA where it's you never know what in the world jersey you're going to be wearing. But I do like to have a little added festivity on the uniforms. And now I'm hearing, I can't confirm this, but the NFL, I believe, is allowing a third helmet.
Interesting.
So we should get
the ones I always liked and it's not because I love these colors, but because it just harkens to Miami Vice. The Miami ones and the neons, they just work because it's that Miami Vice tie-in, yeah. You know, and I know the Heat have done it. I don't know if the Marlins have, but just that whole Miami Vice vibe around the hard neons, I always thought made perfect sense. You know, with the Phillies, I didn't love the powder blues from the early 80s and stuff, but I will say this, as much as I've never been a Phillies guy, I like that old-style Philly P that they had. It always looked right.
The more rounded piece, yeah. That's on, like, with the maroon jerseys.
Yeah, the old school one, I liked it. It always just kind of worked for me. I can't explain it. It's very cartoony, but it worked. And that's what I think of when I think Phillies.
I hate to say this as a Braves fan, but I've always thought that the P that they have as is now is it's a good-looking P. Yeah. It's a good-looking hat. One of my favorite hats in the league. I hate to say this again, but I don't have that hat anymore any longer. I gave it to Goodwill, but it was the blue hat with the red bill and the red P on it. I've always thought that's sharp. I think anything that's royal blue, like even this Milwaukee Brewers hat. Now I'll say the blue and yellow of the Milwaukee Brewers and what they wear today, rather than the blue and the gold that what it was when I was growing up, I'm a big fan of that and the glove on the hat.
It's just weird to me. I mean, I'm still a Milwaukee Brewers in the American League guy.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing I still have a hard time wrapping my head around. And Astros in the American League is foreign to me.
Yeah, see, Astros, you know, still, every now and again, I'm like, wait, shouldn't Houston be in the National League? But
what are the chances the Astros go back when they expand the league?
It'd be interesting to see what they do. I mean, by all indications, if they're going to expand, it's going to be what, Nashville and Salt Lake? And now what? Salt Lake's picking up who?
Arizona Coyotes.
That's right.
So that wouldn't even be an expansion. That would just
I know, but they're talking about Salt Lake being the second baseball expansion as well.
Oh, okay.
So if that's the case, I don't know. I don't know how they balance that. I mean, it would work for me because it would put me back in my 80s mindset, but I don't know that everybody else shares that with me.
How do you think hockey's going to do in Utah, James?
It'll do fine. It's a state that I've played hockey in it. They got a minor league team that sells well. It literally cannot go any worse than it did in Arizona. Mm. That's not really, well, it is the organization's fault because the owners were awful. I mean, the owners were so awful that hotels made them bring certified checks before they would let the team stay.
Wow.
And the NHL is buying that ownership out. That ownership is gone. The NHL is buying that ownership and selling it to, I don't know, whoever's in Salt Lake City.
I missed this on our best and worst of the weekend, but Cal State San Marcos softball player Jillian Albiati had a busy Sunday. She played 13 innings at third base and then went to the plate six times in a doubleheader against Cal State Monterey Bay. Albiati is a sophomore. She became the first woman to play baseball at Cal State San Marcos and just the second NCAA athlete ever to play in a softball and a baseball game on the same day. She's also the first at Division II level to accomplish the feat. Christina Ellsbury of Gallaudet University appeared in a Division III softball and baseball game on April 22nd, 2023. So really cool stuff there. Coach James Hale Show is going to be live with you at 7 in the morning. Inside Drive from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. The Afternoon Underdogs will be back at 4 for James Fife, Coach Brian Haddad. I'm David Hayes. Just remember, Jesus loves you, so do I.
About your past.
Your alarm clock to wake up at the Coach Hales Show on ESPN Northwest Florida. In-depth local and college sports from expert insiders and a dash of controversy.
Can be deadly.
Weekday morning.